Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursaleen. Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in. Wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddini wa ba'd. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every one of us and our offspring. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, we know that in the month of Ramadan, we fast, we abstain from food and drink and permissible sexual desires. So we would be allowed to consume food after the sun has set. And I think a lot of us are very conscious of this, whereby even a small bit of food going into the mouth, we would actually not allow intentionally. Now, if a person has eaten unintentionally, they don't know. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man nasiya wa huwa sa'imun fa akala aw shariba falyutimma sawmahu fa innama at'amahu Allah wa saqah." Whoever has forgotten while they are fasting, and they happen to eat something, and then remember, I was fasting, continue with the fast. It will be a valid fast because Allah has provided that food and that drink for you. Subhanallah. Now, the point I want to raise is, as much as it is important for us to abstain from eating and from consuming food, it is also important for us to save ourselves from falsehood, from lies, from slander, from deception during the fast. And the idea is to train us to become conscious of these bad words so that we don't use them even outside the month of Ramadan. Now, if we were to lie, we pay for it. If we were to slander, we pay for it, even if it is outside of Ramadan. But if it is in Ramadan, it's worse. It's worse. So therefore, let's try and be very, very conscious about this. In fact, today I received a very interesting message from a person who told me that, you know what, I have a problem. What is your problem? Well, I was in the masjid with the latest phone. So the imam looks at it and tells me, how much was your phone? Now I thought to myself, if I'm to give him the proper price, he's going to think this is a rich man. So I'd rather just tell him half the price. So I told him, you know what, it costed me $500. He said, oh, 500. He took out 1,000 and he says, buy me two of them. Subhanallah. Now you are stuck because you lied. What you thought was a problem. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So it's important, just be honest. Say, you know what, I actually lied because of this. And may Allah forgive me, and I want you to forgive me too. That's the way forward. Don't be too embarrassed to say, you know what, Sheikh, I lied. And the reason why I lied was because I thought maybe you might think I'm a rich man or something. But no, subhanallah, the Sheikh turned out to be richer than him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. So this is some of what we have to pay. When you lie, to cover up that lie, you need to create another 100 lies. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on all of us. This evening we're going to move on to Suratul Ash-Shu'ara, which is the 26th surah of the Quran. Shu'ara, named after the poets. There were several poets at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, highly eloquent. Hassan ibn Thabit, Ka'b ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Rawaha radiyallahu anhum jami'an. May Allah bless them all. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed them to use that poetry and the talent that they have in the right direction in order to defend Islam and in order to encourage people to do good. The same would apply today to those who are eloquent, to those who know a little bit of poetry, even those who may, for example, render a few beautiful nasheeds. These nasheed should be encouraging us to obeying the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They should be defending Islam, making clear the position of goodness and truthfulness, rather than encouraging people towards immorality, such as the songs of the globe are. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and guide us. So it is named after the poets, and inshallah, towards the end of that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of some of the points regarding what I've just mentioned now about the poetry. But we may get there by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not today, perhaps another day. Now in the surah, it is a very beautiful surah. It has a lot of verses that actually rhyme. And it has the ending of the stories of the messengers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen to mention in this beautiful surah, always quite similar. And the beginning is also quite similar. Inshallah, we will get to that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts with the story of Musa alayhi salam. Now remember, whenever a story of a messenger is repeated in the Quran, it is in order to highlight a different point. Never is a story mentioned more than once for the exact same reason in the Quran. If it is mentioned, the story of Musa alayhi salam is mentioned most in the Quran. Every time it's highlighting something else. I love the mention of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam's story so much because there is a lot that we can apply in our own lives. And because we are looking at how to save ourselves tonight, we're going to be looking at this story from an angle perhaps that you may not have considered. So let's begin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the story in another surah, Surah Al-Qasas. He starts the story from the birth of Musa alayhi salam. But in this surah, he starts it from the point that he called out to Musa alayhi salam. So it's the prophethood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ نَادَى رَبُّكَ مُوسَىٰ أَنِ ائْتِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ قَوْمَ فِرْعَوْنَ. And remember, when your Rabb called Musa alayhi salam, Allah called him. Allah called Musa alayhi salam to go to the oppressor, to go to the nation who were oppressing. And who was that? The people of Fir'aun. Fir'aun and his cronies. Now, when the oppressor, and usually when there is a tyrant ruler, he has around him cronies who keep encouraging him to do bad. There is no one around him who reminds him that, you know what you are doing is bad, but they actually encourage him to do that which is bad. Fir'aun was no exception. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, remember, when Allah instructed Musa alayhi salam to go, what happened? Now I'm only going to stick to this particular surah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, he went and he told Musa alayhi salam what Allah told him. Sorry, Musa alayhi salam told the Pharaoh what Allah told him to tell the Pharaoh. And listen to the reply. Listen to what the Pharaoh says. Verse number 18 of Surah 26.
قَالَ أَلَمْ نُرَبِّكَ فِينَا وَلِيدًا وَلَبِثْتَ فِينَا مِنْ عُمُرِكَ سِنِينَ.
Have you not lived? Did we not take care of you when you were young? Didn't you grow up with me? And you lived for so many years of your life with us? What is he trying to say? How dare you come and tell me something like this, to worship Allah alone? How dare you instruct me and you guide me when I have done so much of good to you in your life and in my life? I've done so much good to you. I raised you. Had I not raised you, where would you have been today? And you still have the guts, the audacity to come to me and tell me that I need to worship Allah and Allah alone? Now we pause for a moment. Do you know that a lot of us do this? A lot of us would never expect a person whom we've helped to come and correct us. A person whom we have raised, your own child sometimes, if they were to correct you, sometimes we think, who are you? I helped you. Someone who works for you. Someone who cleans in your house, for example, a helper. We would never like it if they came to us and corrected us. Subhanallah. You know, it's just so difficult for us to look at it when we are perpetrating it. But it's easy to look at it when someone else is perpetrating it. Sometimes our children correct us. What do we say? You have no right to tell me I'm your father. Beloved dad, you're making a mistake. Come on. The story of Ibrahim alayhi salam also has something similar. He corrected his father. The father refused. Don't be like that. You are wrong. You are wrong. Totally wrong. So look at him. He says, didn't we raise you when you were a kid? He's trying to justify that whatever I've done, leave me alone. It's okay. So, and didn't you spend so many years of your life with us in a palace? You had such a beautiful life. Today you want to come and tell me what to do? No. My brothers and sisters, let us save ourselves. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of the stories of the previous nations, He does not make mention of them just for us to read them and smile about what happened in the past, but rather, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبَرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ.
الْأَسْبَابِ.
Indeed, in all the stories of the previous nations, there are lessons for those who have sound intellect. If you have sound intellect, when you read a story, stop at every point and ask yourself, how does this apply to me? How can I learn a lesson from it? If you were to do what they did, the result will be similar to the result that they received. You need to know, if you keep on sinning the way they sinned, Allah is going to punish you the way He punished them. If you do what they did, you will come to a conclusion, or you will end up where they ended up. This is what Allah is trying to tell us. This is the reason why Allah has made mention of these stories. It's not just a pastime. Yes, we enjoy reading about how others were punished, but we forget to think, if I'm doing the same thing, I'm also going to be punished. Subhanallah. If I were to ask even the children the stories, they would tell me the story of Nuh alayhi salam. Well, what went wrong there? What exactly went wrong? It's up to us to learn. Go out, read. The stories of the messengers are there. They are in books. Subhanallah. A lot of detail is found even in the Quran. It's amazing. But don't make the mistake that shaitan wants you to make. And that is to think that it doesn't affect me or apply to me in any way. The lesson definitely applies to us. What was the lesson? They transgressed. They went against Allah's command and instruction. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dealt with them in a specific way. So I'd better look into myself. I don't want to be dealt with in that particular way. I want the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when He told Musa alayhi salam all of that, you know, the favors, He counted the favors. Musa alayhi salatu wa salam tells him,
وَتِلْكَ نِعْمَةٌ تَمُنُّهَا عَلَيَّ أَنْ عَبَّدْتَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ.
This little favor that you're counting, that you've done for me, you're using it to justify the fact that you have enslaved the whole of Banu Israel. So because you did a favor to me, does that mean you can get away with the crimes that you've committed against Banu Israel? One thing that you say you did for me, and you trying to tell me that you have enslaved the whole of Banu Israel, and that's okay. No one must talk to you about that. Subhanallah. My brothers and sisters, in our lives, sometimes we are guilty of this. There are so many challenges. I receive emails on a daily basis. On a daily basis, wallahi, of children complaining about their parents. Children complaining about their parents. I do know that we do have the problem of parents who complain about their children. But sometimes, especially nowadays, because the globe has become a little village, we have major issues, my brothers and sisters, major issues. As parents, remember, fulfill what Allah has instructed you to fulfill. Because the children actually belong to Allah. The children belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are only given to you as a trust. Remember, you need to fulfill that in the way that Allah wants. Because when you go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's going to say, by the way, when you were on earth, I gave you this and that and that. How did you do? What did you do with all the things I gave you? Your children were some of the things that Allah gave you. You need to answer in the correct way. May Allah make it easy for us all. May Allah bless those who don't have children with children who will be the coolness of their eyes. Amen. Amen. So my beloved brothers and sisters, that was the response of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Simple. Now, you know, when there is a person who's arrogant, and this is to save ourselves from this type of response. When someone corrects you, you say, Jazakallah khair, may Allah reward you, thank you very much, I appreciate it, etc. This evening, mashallah, I was corrected. What an honor. What an honor to be corrected regarding the mistake you may have made while reading the word of Allah. I will never get upset if someone yells a correction from anywhere in the masjid. It is an honor, wallahi. For a person like me, I know to read the word of Allah correctly is more important than people thinking he made a mistake and he didn't make a mistake. No big deal. You can make 10 mistakes for as long as at the end you got it right. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless those who made the effort to try and correct. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the best memory for His word, inshallah. Ameen. So my brothers and sisters, we should not be from among those who get angry when they are corrected. I said it yesterday. Look at Fir'aun. When he was told by Musa alayhi salam, be careful. Don't let this make you think that it's justified what you're doing. He says to the people around him. This is verse number 25.
قَالَ لِمَنْ حَوْلَهُ أَلَا تَسْتَمِعُونَ.
He tells the people around him,
Are you listening? Are you listening to what this guy is saying? Typical arrogance.
Imagine you're sitting on your chair. A man comes to you and tells you, you know what? What you've done is actually wrong. You give him one or two words. You tell him, you, who are you? You are nothing. I started your business. I did this for you. I did that for you. And then after a little while, when you have no response because he tells you, look, what you're doing cannot be justified, then the man starts laughing and he looks at his cronies and his managers and everyone else. He says, are you listening to him? That is an evil laugh. Astaghfirullah. That is evil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from haughtiness and arrogance. Remember yesterday I told you that there were three things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not look at a person on the day of judgment if they do those three. I mentioned two and I left one, right? I thought I'll mention it today so that at least you can come back, inshallah. Okay, so the two, let's recap. One was a person who brags, a person who keeps on saying, like what Fir'aun is doing here, he's bragging about what happened in the past. I did this for you, I did that for you. Well, that doesn't make right wrong, or nor does it make wrong right. Whatever you did, you did. But what's wrong will still remain wrong. The second thing, a person whose garments are dragging on the floor, and a man who is wearing his garments below his ankles. Again, it leads back to pride and haughtiness. It's the same quality. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this quality. And the third one was, he who sells a commodity with an oath lying about his cost price and his pricing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Now you know all three. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from all of this. Ameen. My beloved brothers and sisters, so he looks at his people and he says, hey, are you listening? Are you seeing? And when they looked, they're obviously going to laugh as well, laughing at a man. That was a Nabi of Allah. That was a messenger of Allah. The people were laughing at him. All of them were doomed as a result of that laughter. Do you know that? Because they didn't realize who it is that Allah brought in front of them. This is why, my brothers and my sisters, there might just be a person walking on the street, maybe even perhaps a person looking like a vagabond on the side of the road. You don't realize how close they might be to Allah. Speak with respect to everyone. You will never go wrong. Speak with dignity. There could be a non-Muslim. Speak with utmost respect. You never know what is going on in his heart or her heart at that particular moment. It could just be the final moment. I remember reading a story about a man who was a bus driver, and a person walked in and intentionally gave him more, and it was a small amount, and this man wanted to accept Islam from a long time, and he said, the bus driver is a Muslim fellow, you know, he's bearded and so on, let me test him, let me see what these guys are all about. Now it's wrong, obviously it's wrong, because you got to base religion on the scriptures, not on the people, because sometimes the people may not be following the scriptures. So now, as this bus driver is thinking, you know what, there's a small amount of change. Should I or shouldn't I? Should I or shouldn't I? He thought for a moment, maybe I should just leave it. It's okay, fine. I don't think he really minded, because he just gave it to me and he carried on. Then he said, no. You know, subhanAllah, he said, no, I will give it. So he actually gave the man the change. And the man got hold of the change and he said, wallahi, you know what? He says, my decision to enter the fold of Islam, for some strange reason, was going to be connected to your reaction, because you're a Muslim. And I just wanted to see what it's all about. And this man who's narrating the story says, wallahi, I was going to sell my deen for 50 cents. I was going to sell this whole deen for 50 cents. Small amount, imagine. So learn to be honest. You never know. The moral of what I said is, you never know what's going on around you at times. Just be kind. Just be respectful. And inshallah, you will never go wrong. Even if a person hates on you, that's a new term that they use nowadays, isn't it? Haters. Even if a person hates on you, don't worry. You be respectful. You continue. And you make sure that you are a person who's still kind. They must not affect your good qualities because they have a bad quality. No, you continue with your good quality. The minute you lose it, you now join their ranks, and you might even do a better job in becoming bad. So you become worse. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So he tells his people, are you listening to this guy? They started laughing. Then he said to some of the Banu Israel, he says, إِنَّ رَسُولَكُمُ الَّذِي أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ لَمَجْنُونَ. Now that's another step, another sign of arrogance. This man who has been sent, the messenger sent to you, is a madman. He's a madman. Brothers and sisters, save ourselves
from uttering accusations against people, wallahi, it will come back to haunt us. Don't just call people bad names. We are Muslims. We are supposed to be having the cleanest tongue. Yet, sometimes our tongues are filthier than those who don't believe, because they have self-respect sometimes. Watch the tongue. Wallahi, it causes a disaster. When you issue a word, it actually comes back to you, because you will pay for what you've said. You have to pay. And you might think, no, it was light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about it. It was written. Be careful. Say a good word. What did it cost you? Zero. Nothing. It didn't cost you even half the price of the mobile phone we spoke about at the beginning of this talk. Nothing. It costed you zero. But no, we are too, I don't know the word. Only an Afrikaans term comes to my mind right now. But it's okay, we leave it. But that's our behavior sometimes. We are stuck up, you know. That's it. We don't want to say a good word. Why not? Your expression, break into a smile. It doesn't cost you a penny. Not a penny. It will help you, wallahi. And say a good word or remain silent. So he says, this man is a madman. Allahu Akbar. They said something similar to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember, they said he was, astaghfirullah, magician. Then they said he was bewitched. Then they said he was mad, etc. He was after women. He was after power. He was after this. All those words, they paid for those words later on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May He strengthen us. May He protect us from uttering bad words about others. Because when you utter bad words about others, a day will come when others will utter bad words about you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never let that happen. Ameen. So, then he started threatening. You see, you start off one stage, then another stage. If it doesn't work, you go to the third stage. What's the third stage? Normally, a big guy will say, hey, I'll fix you. You know, I'll beat you up. I'll show you. Watch out. I'm coming for you. These are the type of words we hear, the gangsters uttering. People who want to threaten others, you know. They look, that's what Fir'aun was doing to a messenger of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do you think the result of that type of statement was? Total destruction. Fir'aun was destroyed. So we are going to save ourselves from similar words like the Pharaoh so that we are not destroyed. Are you seeing how we've looked at it from that angle to say we need to save ourselves? So when we read the story, watch, ask yourself, do I use bad words to others? No matter who they are. If you do, be careful. Because here it is in the Quran, when the Pharaoh did it, he served a punishment. When we do it, the punishment will be proportionate. I mean, we're not Pharaohs at the end of the day, but the punishment is proportionate. It will come back to us in one way or another. Save yourselves from that. Say the good words. Don't threaten people. So Fir'aun tells him, verse number 29, قَالَ لَئِنِ اتَّخَذْتَ إِلَٰهًا غَيْرِي لَأَجَعَلَنَّكَ مِنَ الْمَسْجُونِينَ. He used to say, I'm the God, right? If you worship any other deity besides me, I'm going to jail you. How? He used to call himself a God. He knew he wasn't a God, but he used to call himself a God. So he says, if you're going to worship a deity besides me, I'm going to jail you. Subhanallah. So Musa alayhi salam needed to reply to this, because this is a big man. Musa alayhi salam knows what he can do, but he knows that Allah is even bigger. There is no one bigger than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he knows he's a messenger. But Allah told him, when Allah sent him to the Pharaoh, beautiful words. When Allah sent him to the Pharaoh, him and his brother Harun and Musa, Moses and Aaron, may peace be upon them. Allah says, go to the Pharaoh, the two of you. And how should you speak? Listen to what Allah says. فَقُولَا لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ أَوْ يَخْشَى. Go and tell him soft words. Perhaps he might be reminded, or he might be fearful. He might understand, or it might impact him if you speak with soft words. Now pause for a moment. My brothers and sisters, if you want to impact on anyone, especially when it comes to religion, you need to use the most beautiful words, the softest words, layyinan, that which is very soft. My brother, I love you. We are all trying to go to Jannah and we will meet each other there. But let's make this journey easy by helping each other to tread the beautiful path towards paradise. Talk like that. You don't have to say, you don't read salah, burning. You're burning. It's correct. Technically speaking, it may be a statement that's right. But encourage the brother. Speak about the benefits of salah, what you gained, how you feel. Wallahi, they will feel the need and the urge. Subhanallah. There is a way to talk. If Allah told the best of the time, who was Moses, may peace be upon him, to go to the worst of the time, who was the Pharaoh, and Allah told him to say soft words, I promise you, we can never be better than Moses, and whoever we go to can never be worse than the Pharaoh, so we need to be even softer. You get the point? That's a powerful point. None of us can claim we're better than Musa alayhi salam. And we can never claim, you know, the uncle down the road, hey, he puts the Pharaoh to shame. No way, no way. The Pharaoh was worse. Allahu Akbar, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us hidayah and guidance. So my beloved brothers and sisters, this man, Musa alayhi salam, helped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, what if I've brought a sign? What if I have something? You are telling me not to worship a deity besides you, or you will jail me. What if I've brought you a clear-cut sign? قَالَ أَوَلَوْ جِئْتُكَ بِشَيْءٍ مُّبِينٍ. So the Pharaoh says, قَالَ فَأْتِ بِهِ إِن كُنْتَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ. He says, okay, bring it. Let's see. If you are truthful, I want to see the sign. I want to see the sign. So you all know what happened. The Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam showed him two signs. The one was when he put his stick down and it became a serpent. And the other was when he showed his hand and it was very, very white, bright, shining with nur. And this was all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Pharaoh still, no, not good enough. This, my guys can do this. Typical answer. You come with the best product and say, no. Don't worry, I can do this. It's okay. Just walk. Respect people. My brothers and sisters, you never know what's coming. So listen to what happens here. He says to his people, you know what? We can bring all the magicians from the land. Bring them forth and we're going to face this man. He's just a magician. So they started calling him a magician. So they brought all the magicians and the magicians came. Now, something interesting happens. When a person works for Allah, who gives him the reward? Allah. When a person works for that which is besides Allah, what does he expect? A different type of a reward. Agreed? So, yes, when we work in our day-to-day lives, we have a job. We do the job dedicatedly, bearing in mind that Allah has placed on our shoulders the responsibility of the fulfillment of the agreement between the employee and the employer. We know that. So we will work. Even if the employer is not watching, we fear Allah. So we work properly. And we expect a reward for having fulfilled that part of the agreement. One is from Allah, because we were honest. And two, from the person we worked for, because we achieved what was meant to be achieved through the contract, whatever it was. So it doesn't mean you're not allowed to take a salary. But for us, what is more important is the dignity and the respect. Subhanallah. You work at someone's house or someone's place. You work anywhere and your boss treats you like dirt. You probably will hand in your resignation even if the salary was good. Subhanallah. Unless it was really, really good, you might think that, you know what? Well, he pays me for all these swear words. It's fine. But very few people would do that. Very few people would do that. Let's learn to respect those who work for us. Ameen. So, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he is now faced with a large number of magicians who were gathered. Some narrations take it to the tens of thousands. You know, it's huge, the number who came in. And the Pharaoh called them. Guess what they told the Pharaoh? Look here. Before we actually do what we have to do, we know that we're going to win. This guy is one guy. He's not experienced. We don't know him from amongst us. We know we're going to win. But what we want to ask you is, what will we get if we win? Typical. They're worried about, let's agree first. How much? Will you make us some VIPs here, you know? You're going to give us a good position. What's going to happen? Well, that's exactly what they said. You know what? I'll read for you this verse. قَالُوا لِفِرْعَوْنَ أَإِنَّ لَنَا لَأَجْرًا إِن كُنَّا نَحْنُ الْغَالِبِينَ. They told Fir'aun, hey, are we really going to get that reward and recompense if we win here? And Fir'aun says, yes, I'm going to make you مُقَرَّبِينَ. You're going to be my cronies, my chiefs. You guys will come close to me. Don't worry. You'll win. So they made a big mistake. What was the mistake? Number one, they were worried about the money. Musa alayhi salam is standing there.
He just knows, I got my stick, that's it. Allah is with me. And these people came with their sophisticated items. It reminds me when we went fishing once. Well, not me, but the brothers went fishing. And they took the most sophisticated rods, the latest ones. They paid thousands for these rods with twine and the works. And the bait was so expensive. They bought. And here there was a small boy in shorts, you know, in shorts. He had a stick with a twine hanging down, taking a worm down there. Every little while he's coming out with one fish, looking at those uncles. Then another one picks up. And these people got superb rods, but nothing's happening. Wallahi, it reminds me of this. Musa alayhi salam. When Allah helps you, subhanallah. Those people got their rods, they forgot to say one small word. Bismillah. That's what they forgot. So where are they going to catch all those fish? Subhanallah. This young boy must be reading the whole Quran. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. So save yourselves this embarrassment by calling out to Allah and understanding that the help comes from Allah. Who does it come from? Look at Musa alayhi salam. He was calm. How did he save himself from fear on that day? Through the reassurance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to save yourself from fear. You need to be close to Allah. Your fear will go. You know Allah is with you. You are honest. You are an upright person. What do you need to worry about? Don't. And even if some form of damage does come in your direction, that was the will of Allah. You are so close to Allah, you know. But the problem is when you're far from Allah, you rely on everything besides Allah. That's where you go wrong. I'm not saying don't take heed and don't make whatever you have in terms of effort and don't, you know, protect yourself. But what I am saying, my brothers and sisters, is we definitely need to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ultimate fulfillment of what we wish. Yes. Allah's given you energy. Allah's given you capacity. Use your mind. Use your capacity. Use everything. But ultimately seek from Allah. He's the one who will allow that to pass. So here comes Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. These people, they say, بِعِزَّةِ فِرْعَوْنَ إِنَّا لَنَحْنُ الْغَالِبُونَ. They say, with the power of the Pharaoh, you know, like they are saying, in the name of the Pharaoh, we will be the winners. Musa alayhi salam, it's in the name of Allah. There's no Pharaoh. Pharaoh is not his God. And he made it clear. So now that they all put in their sticks and serpents and ropes and whatever else they had, and these started moving, swaying like they were snakes. You know, the eyes of the people were actually looking at them as though they were moving. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he says his prayer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he throws it down, Bismillah, it becomes huge and it swallows. It swallows everything that was there on that field, gone, disappeared. Guess what else? Allah gave him the miracle that when he tried to take it back, it became the stick again. What happened to everything else? Disappeared. Thin air, gone. Wow. Now, the people who were there were masters in magic. They were masters. This man, he was a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Immediately, what these people did, they fell prostrate. Immediately fell prostrate. Why? Because they knew this is no magic. This is from Allah. And inshallah, tomorrow we will see what happened after that. Because Fir'aun was very, very upset. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for having overshot by almost 4 minutes. But subhanallah, I wish I had a stick. I could pull it back. May Allah bless us all. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.